Hello students, today in this lecture we are going to see the context of Utopia and a little bit of the background of Thomas More as a writer. Now here we see that Thomas More was a writer who was born in 77 and died in 1535, and it was considered to be, Utopia was considered to be the 16th century dream of Thomas More. So it was the first written or first formal Utopia. Here he imagined a complex self-contained world set on an island in which communities shared a common culture and a way of life. So this selection of extract illustrates many of the systems and practices that More imagined for his utopians. He defined systems of punishment, social hierarchy, system of agriculture, system of education, as well as the system of custom for marriage and dress and death as well. Now, when we look at the background of Thomas More, we find that he was Sir Thomas More, who was an English lawyer, writer, and statesman. He was at one time one of Henry VIII's most trusted civil servants, becoming Chancellor of England in 1529. However, we find that More was also a very passionate defender of Catholic orthodoxy. More wrote in the 16th century, and it was a time of the Reformation. So, which set out to reform the Catholic Church in Europe and resulted in the development of Protestantism. When Henry established the Anglican Church, which allowed Henry to divorce Catherine of Aragon, More resigned his chancellorship, or he resigned from his chancellorship, and he continued to argue against the king's divorce, the Reformation, and the split with the Catholic Church. And later he was tried for treason and executed by beheading on 6th of July 1535. Now, when we look at the context of this book, we find, first of all, we see the religious conflict in 1500. So, in 1500, the 1500s were a time of great religious upheaval, not only in England, but also throughout Europe. While the Pope was extraordinarily powerful, his authority was challenged in 1517 by the daring writings of German reformer Martin Luther. So we all know that he was one of the most famous reformer of 16th century. So Luther's 95 theses attacked what he thought were corrupt practices to abusive saints. Luther stated that the Bible was the ultimate authority of Christians. He said salvation was attained through faith and not deeds. Luther's writing, including the famous 95 Theses, refuted many of the practices and beliefs of the Catholic Church and led to the events of Protestant Reformation, which was from 1517 to 1648. So this Reformation was essentially a religious split among Europeans. Some continued to practice Catholicism and follow the Pope, and others became Protestants. Now, Thomas More was a dedicated Catholic and was attracted to the practice of the practices and beliefs of religious monks. At the same time, however, he had a surprising willingness to consider and even espouse humanistic ideas like those of his friend Erasmus, who was a very famous Dutch philosopher. So it is now important to note that Utopia was written just before Martin Luther's thesis, and they were made public. So the book was not a reaction to that event. The ideas in Utopia, however, are directly contradictory to many of these of those of the Catholic Church. More died refuting the Reformation and swearing allegiance to Catholicism. Though the book is certainly a work of political satire, it is not completely clear which ideas are More's own and which are intended to be absurd. Some of the passages in Utopia seem to idealize religious life while others make fun of it. Now, when we look at the politics in the time of Henry VIII, we find that Thomas More became active in Parliament during the time of Henry VII. When Henry VII died in 1509, his only surviving son, Henry VIII, became king. Henry VIII married his brother's widow, Catherine of Aragon, as a way to maintain the alliance between Spain and England. So Catherine, after many years of marriage, had not had son. Though she had given birth to a daughter, Henry VIII was eager to father a male heir and determined that he should marry his mistress, Annie Boleyn. Now, as a citizen of Catholic nation, English people of that time were not legally allowed to divorce. King Henry, however, believed certain phrases from the Bible supported his argument that his marriage was not valid. In fact, Pope Clement VII had granted a similar divorce to other members of European royalty. Clement, however, refused this divorce because of his personal connection to Catherine's family in Spain. Now, working with Thomas More, a loyal political ally and friend, King Henry petitioned the Pope. The King also sought the support of other national leaders and continued to seek divorce because it was very important for King Henry to seek a divorce. Now, More supported this effort for a time, hoping the King and the Pope would reconcile. But in 1930s, the possibility of reconciliation ended. So, an advisor suggested that King Henry name himself the religious ruler of England. Now, despite More's opposition, Parliament supported Henry's decision, particularly as the power of the papacy was on the decline with the rise of Reformation. King Henry was finally declared the religious ruler of the new Church of England. Now, he had the power to declare divorce acceptable in the eyes of men and God. So, Thomas More, a dedicated follower of Pope, could not in good consciousness follow the King. That means he was not happy with this decision of the King. So, More resigned from Parliament in 1532. Unfortunately, for More, obviously, he had become a very popular and influential man or figure by this time. So, his decision to resign created a problem for Henry VIII's new government, which was led by Protestant sympathizer. Now, a few years later, Parliament acted to confirm Henry VIII's new authority. In 1534, Act of Succession was declared, and in Henry VIII's marriage was made legitimate, and Anne's daughter Elizabeth was announced the successor to the crown. So, in 1534, Act of Supremacy or Oath of Supremacy named Henry VIII the supreme head of the Church of England. More was asked to sign both of this document, but refused. He refused to do so. He refused to sign these documents. So, this decision of More, which was obviously later regretted by More, made him created a bad impression about More. So, this finally sealed his fate. And he was executed in the Tower of London the following year. Now, when we look at the historical context of Utopia, we find that Utopia was written nearly 500 years ago, before the work of English playwright William Shakespeare and before the founding of the United States. Modern readers may find some of these ideas in the book to be surprising or even shocking. So, it's important therefore to understand the context in which the book was written. So, Utopia is set in the New World, meaning the America. So, it's helpful to remember that the Mayflower on which the pilgrims traveled to America landed in Plymouth nearly 90 years after More wrote Utopia. Even educated English men of More's time knew almost nothing about the New World, which made it a good place to set an undiscovered country. Utopia describes a society in which slavery is considered to be normal. So, the slave trade from Africa to America had recently begun, and many Englishmen were benefiting financially out of this slave trade. So, More's description of slavery is far more liberal and purposeful than the actual slave trade of that time. In Utopia, women and men are educated, and women have a clear place in the society, or they have a defined position in the society. But to modern readers, again, More's description of female rights and power may seem regressive. The reality, however, is that Utopian women had many more rights and freedom than real women in More's England. Now, we see that Utopia describes a world in which communal ownership of homes and property result in an ideal society. So, when More wrote Utopia, however, we find that Europe was still led by monarchs who ruled by divine rights. We can relate it to German philosopher Karl Marx, one of the founders of modern communist theory. would not be born for 100 of years here. So as it came to be, practice Chemnitz resulted in an economic government structure where an authoritarian leader came to control all means of production. So it may seem that Utopia was written as a description of an ideal society. It is here important to remember that Moore was dedicated servant of an absolute monarch and was devoted to Catholic Pope. So he was also deeply religious Christian. Utopia therefore should not be read as a prescription for a perfect world, but instead as a social satire and commentary only. Now when we look at the genre of this book, we find that the concept of utopia and dystopia was or had begun from here onwards. So utopia was the foundation for two very popular type of literature, that is utopian and dystopian or anti-utopian. Now Moore invented the word utopia and was the first to write a fictionalized version of perfect world or society. Since the publication of the book, many very famous authors have used the concept to create perfect worlds. Utopian literature describes societies the author sincerely believes to be ideal, and dystopian literature describes societies the author believes to be the opposite of the ideals or the worst possible societies. So both genres, like Moore's Utopia, have both literary and political purposes. Now some famous utopian work include New Atlantis by Francis Bacon, Erewhon by Samuel Butler, A Modern Utopia by H.G. Wells, and some of the most famous dystopian novels include The Time Machine by H.G. Wells, 1984 by George Orwell, and Fahrenheit 451 by Ray Bradbury, Lord of Flies by William Golding. Now moving onwards, we find that Utopia was a political satire. So Utopia is an example of political satire, a genre that uses comedic or ridiculous element to poke fun at an existing political structure. While it is not a comedy per se, the book includes comic element that would, if presented in a serious format, have inspired a negative response from individual in political power. Though through satire, Moore is able to make statement about justice, power and property that might otherwise have been condemned by the political elite of that time. Now Moore introduces a satirical tone almost immediately by describing the question asked by Hitolde by the character of Moore and Jills. He says that we made no inquiries after monsters than which nothing is more common, because it is not so easy to find states that are well and wisely governed. This statement, taken seriously, is a judgment on the government of England. Taken as a satire, however, it is humorous. Now here we see that satire is used consistently in the description of utopians as well. For example, Hitolde describes their attitude towards mercenaries, soldiers, saying they are hired with offers of vast rewards to expose themselves to all sort of hazards, because the utopians are not at all troubled how many of these happen to be killed, as they could be a means to deliver the world from such a livid and vicious sort of people. Now, if expressed seriously, such a statement would cause offense. But as a satirist, Moore could make his point without fear of giving offense. Now, the political impact of Utopia. When we see, many of the ideas presented in Utopia were not new. Equality among classes and genders had been suggested by earlier writers as well, including Greek philosopher Plato. So, but it's difficult to know how much impact Utopia really had on later political thinkers who may have read the book. It is certainly true, though, that many of the ideas in Utopia were later brought up in a political context and became very important. One of the most important political thinkers whose work relates to that of Moore was German philosopher Karl Marx. He was one of the great developers of communism, and Karl Marx wrote the Communist Manifesto in 1848, in which he describes an ideal egalitarian society. So Marx's ideas became the basis for the Russian Revolution of 1917, where Russian Communist Revolutionary Vladimir Lenin and the Bolsheviks revolted and ended Tsarist rule in Russia. Now, the Russian Revolution in turn made possible the development and rise of the Soviet Union, a collection of societal state and existed in Eurasia between 1922-1991. Now, on much smaller level, many groups have followed the dream of utopia by founding their own perfect societies, and it has been going on since they had read the ideas of utopia, or maybe since they had come to know about this ideology. Example of such utopian societies include communes founded by hippies during the 1960s. Few utopian societies have survived for more than a few decades, and many survive only for a few years. So this is the context of utopia, and with this we end the lecture today. Thank you all.